O city, city, eye of all cities, universal boast, supermundane wonder, nurse of churches, leader of the faith, guide of orthodoxy, beloved topic of orations, the abode of every good thing. O city, that hast drunk at the hand of the Lord the cup of his fury. O city, consumed by fire. These were the laments by Nicetas Chinaitis on the fall of Constantinople to the Crusaders during Unholy Fourth Crusade. Hello friends, I am Hebron Peters, welcome to my YouTube channel. This is part 4 of my series on Crusades, links of my previous parts are given below. Please don't forget to subscribe, like, share and comment. The Fourth Crusade, 1202-1204, was called by Pope Innocent III to retake Jerusalem from its current Muslim overlords. However, in a bizarre combination of cock-ups, financial constraints, and Venetian trading ambitions, the target ended up being Constantinople, capital of the Byzantine Empire and the greatest Christian city in the world. Sacked on April 12, 1204, Constantinople was stripped of its riches, relics, and artworks, and the Byzantine Empire was divided up between Venice and its allies. The Fourth Crusade thus gained its infamous reputation as the most cynical and profit-seeking of all the Crusades. The Byzantines saw themselves as the defenders of Christendom, a light which shone out across the Mediterranean and Central Asia, hosts to the holiest city outside Jerusalem, and the rock which stood against the tide of Islam sweeping in from the east. By the western half of the old Roman Empire, though, the Byzantines were regarded as decadent, shifty, and untrustworthy, even their religious practices were suspect. This essential division between the east and west had caused constant problems in all the previous crusades, and it was to crop up again in this one. There were also more concrete sources of division, the historical rivalry between popes and emperors, and the rising ambition of Western states to wrest from Byzantium the remnants of its empire in Italy were fueled by the failures of the Crusades in permanently securing the Holy Land for Christendom. Blame was apportioned to either side for the lack of success. The Byzantines were considered to lack the will to fight the common Muslim enemy, while, from the other side, the Crusaders were seen as opportunists out to grab the choicest parts of the Byzantine Empire in the east. In a sense, both sides were right in their judgment. Unlike the previous crusade, this was not to be a king's crusade. Still, a good number of second-tier nobles were inspired to join up or take the cross, as it was known, especially from northern France. There were the Counts of Champagne and Blois, although the former would die before the expedition got underway, Geoffrey of Villehardouin, who would later write his conquest of Constantinople, an important record of the crusade, Count Baldwin of Flanders, and Simon de Montfort. In August 1201 the leader of the expedition, after the untimely death of Theobald of Champagne, was selected. The choice was an immensely rich and chivalrous Italian with an impressive crusader pedigree in his family, Marquis Boniface of Montferrat. Perhaps significantly, given future events, Boniface also had family connections with the Byzantine Empire, one of his brothers marrying the daughter of Byzantine Emperor Manuel I and another brother marrying the sister of the deposed Byzantine Emperor Isaac II Angelos. In October 1202 the army was finally ready to set sail from Venice to Egypt, seen as the soft underbelly of the enemy, or at least, that was the original plan. The Venetians, being the rapacious traders they were, insisted that their 240 ships be paid for, but the Crusaders could not meet the astonishing asking price of 85,000 silver marks, double the annual income of France at the time. Consequently, a deal was made that in return for passage the Crusaders would stop off at Christian city Zara on the Dalmatian coast and reconquer it for the Italians, the city having recently defected to the Hungarians. The Venetians would also provide 50 warships for the crusade at their own cost and receive half of any territory conquered. The Pope was not best pleased to hear the news that Christian city Zara had been sacked on November 24, 1202, and he promptly excommunicated the Crusaders and the Venetians. The ban was later lifted for the former, otherwise, they would not have been much use as Crusaders, one supposes. It is also true that many of the Crusader leaders, notably Simon of Montfort, had actually refused to attack Christian Zara, and a significant number of men had even left the crusade over the issue. In January 1203, en route to Jerusalem, the Crusader leadership entered into an agreement with the Byzantine prince Alexios Angelos to divert the crusade to Constantinople and restore his deposed father Isaac II Angelos as emperor. The intent of the Crusaders was then to continue to Jerusalem with promised Byzantine financial and military aid. On June 23, 1203, the main Crusader army reached Constantinople, while other contingents, perhaps a majority of all Crusaders, continued to Acre. When the Fourth Crusade arrived at Constantinople, the city had a population of approximately 500,000 people, a garrison of 15,000 men, including 5,000 Varangians, and a fleet of 20 galleys. For both political and financial reasons, the permanent garrison of Constantinople had been limited to a relatively small force, made up of elite guards and other specialist units. At previous times in Byzantine history, when the capital had come under direct threat, it had been possible to assemble reinforcements from frontier and provincial forces. On this occasion, the suddenness of the danger posed by the Fourth Crusade put the defenders at a serious disadvantage. The main objective of the Crusaders was to place Alexios IV on the Byzantine throne so that they could receive the rich payments he had promised them. Conan of Bethune delivered this ultimatum to the Lombard envoy sent by the Emperor Alexios III Angelos, who was the pretender's uncle and had seized the throne from the pretender's father Isaac II. The citizens of Constantinople were not concerned with the cause of the deposed emperor and his exiled son. Hereditary right of succession had never been adopted by the empire, and a palace coup between brothers was not considered illegitimate in the way it would have been in the West. On July 3, at Dandolo's suggestion, they tried to trigger a popular rising in young Alexius' favor. Alexius stood dressed in state robes on the poop of a galley that rowed back and forth under the walls of the city to display their rightful emperor to the people. The response was less than overwhelming. When the galley came close to the walls, it was met by a hail of arrows, not by the hoped-for cheers. A Byzantine emperor was not a dynastic king like those of the feudal West. In the Roman imperial tradition, he was more a president for life with absolute authority. Whoever could take the throne and hold it was accepted as emperor. But young Alexius had no special right to the throne simply because he was the son of a deposed former emperor, and whatever the Byzantines thought of their present emperor, they would not take a new one at the hands of foreigners. With the furious battle with Crusaders, Alexius III also had lost his nerve. That night he fled the city with his mistress and a favorite daughter, leaving his empress behind. Byzantine nobles hastily met and restored blinded old Isaac II, young Alexius' father, in disregard of the tradition that made blindness a bar to the throne. When the Crusaders heard of this, they demanded that young Alexius be crowned alongside his father. They still had a powerful army and fleet, they had nearly taken the city, and there was no real leadership among the defenders. The demand was granted, and young Alexius was escorted into the city in state, along with the Doge and the leading French counts and barons. Young Alexius now sat crowned beside his father as Emperor Alexius IV. And next? It was too late in the season to go on, but the Crusaders looked forward to receiving supplies and Byzantine reinforcements. Come spring, they could sail on to Egypt and restore the Holy Land to the cross. Alas, young Alexius could not keep the grand promises he had made. The imperial treasury was empty. The Crusaders, with diplomatic avenues exhausted, their supplies dangerously low, and their ships in need of vital repairs and maintenance, had now little option but to try and take the city. They launched an all-out attack on the morning of April 9, 1204, but the Byzantines repelled it. Then, on April 12, the Crusaders attacked the weaker sea walls of the harbor and targeted two towers in particular by lashing their ships together and ramming them repeatedly. Initially, the defenders held on, but eventually, the attackers forced their way through on both the seaside and the land side, the attackers smashing through the city's gates. A slaughter of the defenders and the city's some 400,000 inhabitants followed. Citizens were raped and massacred, buildings were torched, and churches desecrated. Ducas fled to Thrace, and 3 days of looting followed, where artworks were destroyed, precious goods were melted down, and religious relics were taken to Europe. As an epilogue to the event, Pope Innocent III, the man who had unintentionally launched the ill-fated expedition, spoke against the Crusaders thus, "How, indeed, will the Church of the Greeks, no matter how severely she is beset with afflictions and persecutions, return into ecclesiastical union and to a devotion for the Apostolic See, when she has seen in the Latins only an example of perdition and the works of darkness, so that she now, and with reason, detests the Latins more than dogs. As for those who were supposed to be seeking the ends of Jesus Christ, not their own ends, who made their swords, which they were supposed to use against the pagans, drip with Christian blood, they have spared neither religion, nor age, nor sex. They have committed incest, adultery, and fornication before the eyes of men. They have exposed both matrons and virgins, even those dedicated to God, to the sordid lusts of boys. Not satisfied with breaking open the imperial treasury and plundering the goods of princes and lesser men, they also laid their hands on the treasures of the churches and, what is more serious, on their very possessions. They have even ripped silver plates from the altars and have hacked them to pieces among themselves. They violated the holy places and have carried off crosses and relics. In September 1203, the Fourth Crusade is considered to be one of the final acts in the Great Schism between the Eastern Orthodox Church and Roman Catholic Church, and a key turning point in the decline of the Byzantine Empire and Christianity in the Near East. Byzantine resistance based in unconquered sections of the empire such as Nicaea, Trebizond, and Epirus ultimately recovered Constantinople in 1261. But the empire remained weak and subsequently fall in the Muslim Turks, which became threat to the Western Europe. Hope you liked the video. Please don't forget to subscribe, like, share and comment. Goodbye for now. God bless you. The series is continued.